There you go. Mr. Right to discuss the presentation of no money for the Egyptian tower for Newman Muti Tamburino and I should discuss also about some extension there and the vision of this state. The idea is the following. Without quantum theory for gravitation, it is interesting to investigate the force and the quantity for a particle, a quantum particle on a first space. And the simplest object, the simplest quantum object is a fermion, the simple half of the particle. First of all, I shall discuss the pseudo-practical approach. I mean to use some Grassmann coordinates to take into account the spin degrees of Newton. After that, I shall discuss the Dirac equation on the curve space, and I shall apply the general result for Euclidean tau Newman Muti Tamburino. And after that, we shall discuss the gravitational anomaly and SL anomaly. More exactly, I should like to see what are the differences between classical motion, the classical situation, and what happens when you consider a quantum object, a fermion, on a curved space. Involving the Grassmann coordinates. intention. In that case, it's impossible to express conserved quantity a solution of this equation in terms of a symmetric object, because this equation involves just an anti-commutative polynomial. So this is not the natural object to be used to solve the generalized equations. And in some cases, it is possible to decompose the symmetric object, symmetric tensor, in terms of a product of anti-symmetric Killing-Yano tensors. And in this case, the solution of the generalized equation is the following. Here is the first term is the scalar, the classical term. And you have two terms involving the Gell-Mann coordinate, and the expression contains the Gell-Mann coordinate. So if you neglect the Gell-Mann coordinate, you obtain, of course, the scalar classical solution. In addition, there are some conserved superchances expressed in terms of Gell-Mann coordinate, and these superchances anti-commute which is the standard supercharge. What about Dirac equation? So this is the next step. In the pseudo-classical approach, we used Gell-Mann coordinate to take into account the spinning of it. Now I am using Dirac equation on a first space. As usual, we introduce the covariant derivatives. And what are the conserved quantities? Conserved operators. Conserved operators which compute or anti-compute with the standard Dirac operator. If you have Killing vector, this is the operator which commutes with the Dirac operator. More interesting is the fact that when you have a Killing-Yano tensor, it is possible to construct a non-standard Dirac operator which commutes or anti-commutes. From time to time, say commute or anti-commute, just to use gamma phi to change commutator to anti-commutators. So these are non-standard Dirac operators which anti-commute with the standard one. So when the space admits a Killing-Yano tensor, it is possible to construct additional Dirac operators which are on the same group as the standard Dirac operator. Let us apply the general machinery to the Euclidean Kalman-Mann continuous space. This space appears first of all as an example of gravitational instant. After that, this space was used to describe the monopolytical Kaplan theory in gross space distorting model, and also to describe the motion of two monopoles when you neglect the radiation. This is the method. And you recognize here the field of a monopole. And what are the symmetries? They are 14 vectors. And from these Killing vectors, as usual, from the theorem, you can construct the angular momentum and the so-called relativity charge. More interesting is the fact that, that in the columnar space there are four Schrödinger tensors. The first to see, I is 1, 2, 3, are covariantly constant. And there is another one which admits non-vanishing covariant derivative. So this space is very rich in symmetries.
Yeah. Yeah, you're doing it in the single center configuration. If you have multi compact spaces, multi center spaces, do you also have this three covariantly constant Killing tensors, and do you also have the three Killing vectors?
Four Killing vectors.
Four Killing vectors?
Four Killing vectors.
You have multi center case now. Now this is single center here.
Yeah.
You have multi center, and are there also four Killing vectors?
Yes. Four Killing vectors. And the four working general tensors. And what is interesting, there is a Rutherland vector, a sort of Rutherland vector like in Coulomb problem, which has this form. And this quantity here is a symmetric Killing tensors, which is expressed in terms of a product of Killing-Yang tensors, and here is a product of Killing vectors. More or less, this part is trivial because when you make the product of two Killing vectors, you get a tensor, but this is trivial. This part is non-trivial because you express the symmetric tensor in terms of a product of non-trivial anti-symmetric objects, anti-symmetric tensors. And now let us apply the machinery from pseudo-classical approach. In this case, the total angular momentum contains the scalar part and an additional part which comes from the Grassmann coordinate from the field. And from the Killing-Yanov tensors, you can construct direct type operators. And from the covariantly constant Killing-Yanov tensors, you can construct three Dirac type operators, and in addition, taking the standard Dirac operator, you get this super algebra. So practically, what you have here is more or less the Klein-Gordon operator. And we have four square roots of the Klein-Gordon operator. Usually the standard Dirac operator is the square root of the Klein-Gordon operator. In this case, because the Taunus space is hyperchiral and you have the hyperchiral structure, you have four Dirac operators. One is the standard one, and additional new Dirac type operator constructed from Killing-Yanov tensor. So this is connected with the hyperchiral geometry with the structural geometry. And what about the last Killing-Yanov tensor, which is not covariantly constant? From this Killing-Yanov tensors, you can construct this supercharge, and you can define the Runge length operator for the Dirac theorem. Now, what about the Dirac that discussed about in the social practical approach? What about the Dirac equation in the Talmud phase? Here is the standard Dirac operators, the momentum operator, and some notations. The Hamiltonian, the Kleinboltzmann operator, and here is the total angular momentum, which contains the scalar part plus additional part coming from the field. And we can construct this linear type operator, which is super algebra, like in the pseudo-classical approach. And you have an additional operator constructed from non-covariant constant in gamma central. And you can construct a Runge-Lenz operator having this completion relation. And if you redefine the component of the Runge-Lenz vector, you can get this nice relation, which is what you expect to have from Runge-Lenz vector. Now let us discuss the anomalies. When you have symmetric spinning tensors, you can construct this quadratic constant of motion. Usually this symmetry, this constant of motion are connected to the hidden symmetries of the problem. And in the quantum case, this is the quantum operator, and we want to evaluate the commutator between the scalar attraction and the corresponding quantum operator, what corresponds to the symmetry in the quantum case. And the result is the following. So you can observe that in the classical case, the commutator, this quantity is conserved. But in the quantum case, this commutator you have in the right-hand side, this term. And here there is a Ricci tensor. So when there is a Ricci tensor, when the space is not Ricci set, you have and a gravitational anomaly. This commutator is not zero. However, there is something very interesting. When the space is Ricci flat, of course the right-hand side is zero. Okay. But sometimes it's possible to have zero in the right-hand side. So no gravitational anomalies when the Killing tensor can be decomposed in terms of Killing gamma tensors. More exactly, the integrability condition for a Killing tensor is this, contacted with the Riemann tensor is this. And suppose that the Killing tensor can be decomposed in terms of Killing gamma.
environment control.
In this case, this is the exactly people, and maybe we can recognize this quantity here. So, when the chilling tensor can be decomposed in tensor chilling nano sensor, there are no gravitational anomalies. Now let us discuss the extended tau naught space. This method was introduced by Wai and Takayama. The idea is to modify these two functions, and they find that if GF and G has this expression where A, B, C, D are constants, this space presents a hidden symmetry. What exactly this space has Keating tensors? Of course, when C, where the constants are connected by this relation, from this equation you get the standard Tau-naught space. So what happens in the extended Tau-naught space? There is a Runge-Lenz vector like in the standard Tau-naught space, but what is interesting is the fact that for the extended Tau-naught space, there are standard Keating symmetric tensors, but there are no Keating nano tensors. So, this space is not a Ricci flat. The Keating tensor cannot be decomposed in Keating nano tensors. This Keating nano tensor doesn't exist. So you can expect that in this case to have a gravitational anomaly. And indeed, there are gravitational anomalies. Just to simplify, here are the components of this Keating tensor. And here is the computer. And you can observe that this one in general, but of course when the constant A, B, C, D are connected in this way, you recover the standard Tau-naught space, the space is Ricci flat, this term disappear, is zero, vanishes, and there are no gravitational anomalies. Now, what about Dirac equation? What about the index of a Dirac operator on Tau-naught space? In general, the axial anomaly is connected with the index of the Dirac operator, and the index of a Dirac operator in general, here pathologic signal produced, there is a here pathologic signal formally, there is a formula for the index expressed in terms of two quantities. One contribution is from the bulk and another one from the boundary. When the space is of this form, when X is closed, it is possible to express in terms of the spectral flow of the energy of Dirac operators over the slices in this domain. So here is the theorem, which is telling the fact that the index to compute the index, it is necessary to compute the path of very simple, the spectral flow is the net number of eigenvalues crossing zero to the direction. To me, okay. To compute the index, which means the so-called Bézier family of remanentes, would consider the off equation, and we ignore by GHGB the matrix for horizontal vertical bundles, and Bézier matrix on SPR in this way, and here is the lemma, there are no harmonic lambda. More than two, and here is conflicting theorem concerning the small eigenvalues. We introduce this quantity, and the flow of the Bézier operator, and to apply the this machinery to the Taubner field, we put the Taubner metric in this form, where lambda is in terms of A, B, C, D, the quantity which appear in the metric, and what we get is that the index is expressed as a difference, and finally, the index of the Dirac operator is zero for chi greater than this. So what that means that in the standard Taubner space, the index of the Dirac operator is zero. For small deformation, the index remains zero. But for large deformation of the matrix, it is possible to have an actual anomaly. The index of the operator jumps with one unit because you have discontinuities at the boundary. This is the last minutes or last seconds, some references concerning proto-classical models of Trigian Taubner space, estimated Taubner space by Katayama, operators on curved spaces, and here some papers about Taubner space, Dirac operator on Taubner space, and some references for Axia Patodi-Singer. This paper contains the evaluation of the axial anomaly for the standard Taubner space, and this one contains some the evaluation of the index for the extended Taubner space. And we show that the anomaly is absent for small deformation of the metric. Thank you.
Question. few slides in which I thought I saw a lowest eigenvalue for the error property. Was that true?
Yeah.
The estimates on that.